clearing up this space a little bit. Like I said, me and my machete against the world. When people in Guadeloupe think cocoa, they think chocolate, they think Africa, they think Ghana. We gave chocolate to them, you know, or to not make it a we versus them thing. It's our environment that gave them the cocoa, you know, it came from tropical America, you know, but today the main producers are in Africa. But all of that is going to start to change, man. We're going to be making our local chocolate over here. That's how the Kalinagos was growing it when Christopher Columbus came. That's how we found the cocoa, you know, that's how the Western world found cocoa. In the forest with the Amerindians, you know. So I'm trying to recreate that environment, because today cocoa comes to Guadeloupe on a boat. But Guadeloupe introduced the world to cocoa. The Caribbean introduced the world to cocoa, and today the world is selling cocoa to the Caribbean.
How bizarre.
It doesn't make no sense, man.
So, you know about Bled Miki, right?
Yeah, man. Plante Kako, si me Kako.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's my G, you know, Bled Miki.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You see these trees, man? It's the seeds that Bled Miki gave me, you know.
Oh.
Because I have two kinds of cocoa in my garden. I have Criollo and I have Forastero. But the first year I was planting Forastero. Those are the cocoa trees that make yellow cocoa. But there's also red cocoa, and that's the one they use for luxury chocolate. And that's the one that Bled Miki brought the seeds. So big up Bled Miki for the seeds, man.
Big up Bled Miki.
You see, your seeds are not going to waste, brother. They're in good hands. I have another 6 trees to plant today. Progressing little by little. So all up this slope, I need to plant cocoa, I need to plant jackfruit, I need to plant mango. Let's see how good the ground is today. Sometimes there's so much water in the ground, it can be hard to open up the ground, you know. Or not to open up the ground, but to crumble the ground. Try and break that up a little bit. Get rid of the grass. Plante Kako. Si me Kako.
Kupitita nupele vegaya.
Yeah, man.
Plante Kako, pile Kako, pour petit temps nous pele vegaya ou, gaya ou.
It's a big tune, you know.
That's a big, big
tune. And you have to listen to the lyrics when you listen to them kind of tunes, like.
Yeah.
If you don't speak Creole, you wouldn't understand, but the things that he's saying is real talk, you know. When he's saying, like, you know, Kako la te jala ite kapuse en babwa. All of that is truth, you know. Like I was saying, when Christopher Columbus, he found the chocolate growing in the forest here. And today, chocolat ka vini si bato, like he's saying in the tune. It don't make no sense when you really check it out. That's why we have to plante Kako, man.
So what are you doing right now? You just...
plante Kako. So I'm taking it out of the pot so that it can spread its roots across the ground. You know, and make fruits, because if I leave it in the pot, it's not gonna make no ground. You see, the root had already made it to the bottom of the pot.
Yeah.
If I leave it at the bottom of the pot, if I leave it in the pot, it's not gonna grow, it's not gonna make fruits. So I transplanted it into this humid forest ecosystem where it's gonna be at home and where it can develop and make fruits, you know, because the goal is to make fruits.
Bushman in the bush.
Yeah, man, with a bucket of compost for my cocoa trees. Look at all those skid marks. Yeah, man, this is some compost. A lot of leaves dropped inside it, you know.
This is not necessarily leaves that I put myself, you know. Just things that drop inside it. But you can see, it's full of good compost, man. I could have left it to decompose a little longer, but like I said, a lot of these leaves is leaves that just drop from the forest, you know. So this is a good amendment for when I plant my trees, you know. I put that in the hole and it enriches them, you know.
This is one of my composting stations in the forest. I have another one lower down we can show you later. But this is a pile that I just made a couple of days ago. It's composed of carbon biomass and nitrogen biomass that I found in the forest. So in simple layman's terms, that is green and brown organic matter, leaves essentially, that I found in the forest. And there is also two layers of cow manure in there. So I kind of do it like a lasagna kind of thing. I put a layer of nitrogen, a layer of manure, a layer of carbon, you know, and I just continue like that. So in 3-4 months, that will be looking like this. So you should come and see what this is looking like. I put this here 3 months ago or so. Yeah, I put this here about 3 months ago. Same kind of composition. All local things. My cousin has his cow over there. I take in the manure from there. And I take in the green and brown biomass from the forest and I'm mixing them up in a lasagna and I'm just leaving it there by itself for the microorganisms to turn it into compost. So that is our black carbon, our black gold. I call my compost black gold, you know, because it's worth more than gold in a place like this. It's what's gonna make my fruits grow and you know, feed me. So this is some of what we're gonna be taking to put with our cocoa trees so that they can, you know, have rich soil to grow in. You know, look at that, you know. Beautiful, man. I love composting, you know. I find it so fascinating, the fact that if you had seen this 3-4 months ago, it was looking just like that, except it was in a box, you know, and then the microorganisms and the worms turn it into this beautiful black gold, you know, black carbon. Every living organism is made of carbon. That's the hue mentioned in the word human, the blackness of coal. You ain't heard that? That's one of my favorite songs to listen to when I'm composting, man. Yeah, man. Some good compost to add to our cocoa trees, you know? This is bioeconomy in action. The use of the local natural resources, you know?
Yeah.
The transformation and valorization of the local natural resources. Because in Guadeloupe, we import fertilizers, which come from mines in North Africa, when we could be doing this and in 3-4 months, you have something which can make your soil rich, you know? So why are we importing things from North Africa, from mines in North Africa, where people work in terrible conditions? Something which we know is not sustainable. When they have no more elements in them, in the soil where they're mining, then what are we gonna do? You know, so we might as well start doing this from now. It's more ecological, man. All of this was made with no carbon footprint, man. It's just me chopping down leaves from the forest and arranging them alongside the manure and the leaves, the carbon brown leaves that I gather from the soil to make a rich amendment, you know. Give it a little bit of rich soil to grow inside, you know? You see the root is coming out of the pot. You see, it needs more soil, man. It needs more space to grow. So now, I'm gonna give it that.
Oh yeah, good vibration. Oh yeah, see, look at that. That you can see it better now, because there was a lot of leaves at the top that fell on top of the thing.
Yeah.
Now this is all made in the forest.
Okay, okay.
I cut the leaves off the trees, and I pick the dry leaves off the bottom, and I mix it up with some manure, in like a lasagna kind of style, and it gives me a nice amendment. Scientifically speaking, it's not a fertilizer, but it comes back to the same thing, you know, it gives the plants nutrients. Because people think compost is a fertilizer. It's not. It's an amendment. It's slightly different. The difference is there's a middleman. Because basically this is organic matter. The nutrients are not directly available for the plants. It needs microorganisms to actually mineralize the organic matter to make the nutrients available to the plants. So within it you have nitrogen, you have phosphorus, you have potassium, you have carbon, but they're not directly available to the plants. It's feeding the soil, which then feeds the plants. Whereas when you put fertilizer, it feeds the soil directly. There's no middleman. There's no microorganisms because it's synthetic, isolated molecules. Whereas this is organic, all the nutrients are there, but you need the middleman, the microorganisms, to make it available to the plants.
So what about the cutlass? Do you like the tool? Is it your favorite tool?
Yeah, man. Without a cutlass, none of this wouldn't be possible, man.
Yeah.
It's a cutlass that I use to clean this whole piece of land. When I come here, the weeds was taller than me, and I'm over 6 foot tall. But when I come here, the weeds was taller than me, and I chop everything by myself with my cutlass. Like I say, it's me and my cutlass against the world.
Yes.
In this garden.
When I come to Guadeloupe for the summer, I always have my cutlass also.
Yeah, man.
Not that I have a use for it every day like you, but if I need to go get some coconut or sugarcane,
it can always come in handy, man.
Yes, exactly.
Like sometimes you might be on the road and a tree drops in the road and you have to cut it off. You have to cut it down before you can drive on. So you never know when you're gonna need your cutlass. I'm gonna leave that right there, you know, to protect the soil, enrich the soil. I can gather some of it as mulch as well.
I was asking, how long did it take you to clear all the bush?
I can't even remember, you know. Even now, I'm not finished clearing the bush, man. It's like little by little. I ain't timed nothing that I'm doing here, you know. I just been doing as much as I can. Because all this, what I've been doing it while having a job and while going to school. So I doing this in the afternoon. I doing this on the weekend, you know. I couldn't tell you how long it takes because it still hasn't... I still got a long way to go. So you see the color of the soil, man? It's red soil. That means it's not particularly rich in organic matter. This is what is known in English scientifically as feral sol, or in French, sol feralitique. So within that word, you have fer and you have al. And the fer is for iron and the al is for aluminium. Mm-hmm. Those are the two main ingredients that make up the soil. And it's quite poor in organic matter, you know. In Grantel, the soil is more rich. Because in Grantel, the island was underwater about 6,000 years ago when there was the global flood that every indigenous culture and the Bible has an account of. So the Grantel is more rich in organic matter because all of the old shells and things from the sea creatures actually rotted into the Grantel soil. That's why when you go to Grantel, you find more rocks and the soil is darker and more rich in organic matter. But Bastel is a different origin. Bastel is a volcanic island. Bastel was created by fire and lava, and Grantel was created by water. So the water brought a lot of things from the sea, the bones of the fish and things like that, and the shells that enriched the Grantel soil. But, you know, this is what we get in Bastel, man. So that's why I bring in compost to my trees, you know? Because I want my soil to be black carbon, you know? Like midnight, say, man. Yeah. So we put a little bit of black gold in there. We put our cocoa. Welcome to your new home. I know he's gonna be happy to be in this new cool environment. Probably put a little bit of it just to fill up the gap, but I'm gonna... fill it up a little bit. I'm gonna finish off with... It's a good feeling, man, knowing that I made this soil here, man. It's a good feeling, man, knowing that I made this soil here, man. Depuis un temps Kalinago, depuis un temps Azawa, Kikakola déjà là, il te capoussé en babwa. Voyez la toute l'année là, mon commande pour chocolat.
yo manje pou la Noël, pou Saint-Valentin la pou Pâques. Chocolat ka arrive si bateau pepa sente se bon kako. Kako la ka pousse yon babwa, c'est li ki ran vous gaya. Chocolat ka arrive si bateau peni produit chimique yo. Kako la ka pousse yon babwa popa. Plante kako, pile kako, pou petit an nou pe leve gaya ho. Gaya ho, gaya ho.